Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's TASSI webinar, Turkish Association for Seismic Isolation webinar. My name is Mehmet Emre Özkanlı and I am the president of TASSI. In TASSI webinar series, worldwide reputed seismic isolation experts present on seismic isolation applications in their countries. Today, Dr. Paolo Clemente is presenting seismic isolation in Italy, design, application and monitoring. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the question box in our TASSI YouTube channel chat panel. I'll bring them up during the presentation and we will also have time for questions at the end. Especially, I would like to thank Mr. Paolo Clemente, who's ASSISI president, as he distributed our webinar announcement to all ASSISI members throughout the world. I would like to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Paolo Clemente, briefly. Paolo Clemente got his civil engineering degree at University Federico II of Naples and his PhD in structural engineering. He also carried out postdoctoral research activities at the Bridge Construction Institute at the Faculty of Engineering of the University Federico II of Naples, Italy. His main fields of interest are as follows: experimental vibration analysis of structure system, system identification, development and application of new anti-seismic technologies, suspension bridge, cable state bridge, masonry arch bridge, structural preservation of cultural heritage. Other fields of interest are as follows: structural stability, reticular, spatial and tension structures, numerical modeling of bridges, wind effects on structures, structural control, seismic microzoning and local seismic response. Now he's research director at ENEA. He was head of Department of Prevention of Natural Risks and Effects Mitigation of ENEA from 2010 to 2015. He was adjunct professor at the Faculty of Architecture, Valle Gili University, Sapienza of Rome, at the Faculty of Engineering of the Mediterranean University of Reggio Calabria, at the Faculty of Engineering, University of Toronto, and the Master on Anti-Seismic Engineering at L'Aquila University. He had previously collaborated for the courses Theory and Design of the Bridges and Special Structures of the Faculty of Engineering of the University Federico II of Naples. He also took lessons as part of the doctorate courses, joint master programs, and refresher courses for engineers. He was president of Panel 15, Sciences and Technologies for Sustainable Development and Governance, Financial, Energetic and Environmental Aspects, and member of Panel 8, Civil Engineering and Architecture in the framework of the Italian Research Evaluation performed in 2005. He was member of SOGIN Scientific Committee for Italian National Deposit. He has been audited several times in parliamentary committees on subject of his fields of interest. He took part in several projects and was coordinator of EU cooperative research project proposals. He took part in several international conferences, also as keynote or invited speaker. He gave the keynote lecture on modern anti-seismic systems at the 16th World Conference on Earthquake Engineering held in Santiago, Chile. He organized several workshops, special sessions in Italian and international conferences, as well as special issues of international and Italian journals. He is associate editor of Journal of Civil Structural Health Monitoring and member of the editorial boards of the International Journal of the Earthquake and Impact Engineering. He is president of the Anti-Seismic Systems International Society, we can say ASSISI. Now he's president of ASSISI, member of Council of the International Society for Structural Health Monitoring of the Intelligence Infrastructure, and member of the Direction Council of the Italian Association of Earthquake Engineering. He is author of more than 360 scientific works in structural engineering and 4 patents. And now I would like to give the stage to Dr. Paolo Clemente. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening to everybody. Thank you to President Özkanlı for inviting me. Thank you to Dr. Sadan Thank you. Good evening to all the members of the TASI, the Turkish Association for Seismic Isolation. It's a great pleasure for me to give this presentation for your association. Now I'm going to share my screen and to start my presentation. Okay, my presentation this evening, because it's evening in Turkey, but also in Italy, will be a state of the art of seismic isolation in Italy with the recent application and also experimental analysis during recent seismic event in Italy. My presentation is organized in five chapters. First of all, an introduction, then I'll show you some consideration about the isolation devices. Then I'll give you some idea about the preliminary design of seismic isolation systems. And then I show you the applications in Italy, both to new and existing buildings. And finally, I'll show you the most interesting results of some experimental analysis of base isolated buildings in Italy. Well, just to give a very general introduction, seismic isolation, as you know, is based on the analysis of the elastic response spectrum in terms of acceleration. This spectrum gives the maximum acceleration in a structure as a function of its fundamental period of vibration. The acceleration spectrum blue line in this diagram starts from the peak ground acceleration, which is the value for t equals zero, and presents its maximum amplification in a range of period up to 1 second, more or less. Unfortunately, most of the civil structures have a fundamental period exactly in this range. With the seismic isolation, we increase the fundamental period of vibration, usually to more than 2 seconds, so that acceleration can be reduced significantly. This reduction is offset in terms of displacements, of course. This is displacement increase with the period of vibration, the red line in this diagram, but these displacements are concentrated at the base of the building, while the superstructure behaves almost like a rigid body. In such a way, we realize the coupling between the motion of the structure and the motion of the soil. And it is possible designing in the elastic range, obtaining a so-called zero earthquake damage building. Well, it is an ingenious idea, but it's not a new idea. The ancient Greeks used foundation composed by a continuous stone plate separated from a marshland by means of a layer of clay mixed with charcoal and ashes. And a similar solution was proposed by Calantrientes in 1909. He used a layer of talcum powder between the foundation and the structure. But the first engineered device was developed by Stevenson in 1868. He called this device a seismic joint. It consisted in spherical rollers in niches and was used for to protect the lighting system in Japan. Well, it is interesting to read what Stevenson wrote about his system, because he understood very well the concept of seismic isolation. I'll read. It is evident that any sudden lateral motion of the earth on which the building rests must be communicated to the foundation of the structure and thence through all the rigid and unyielded materials of which it is composed to its very summit, where the violence of the shock will be aggravated by the greater elevation and the highest point of the building above the source of motion. On fully considering this action of earthquakes, it occurred to me that what was required to neutralize their shocks was a break in the continuity of the rigid parts forming the structure, so as to prevent the propagation of the shock with increasing violence from its foundation to its summit. The idea being that in some horizontal plane of the building should be cut through and separated, so that the sound and motion of the lower portion should not be directly communicated to the superincumbent building. Well, the history of seismic isolation is quite long, but the two events of the last century were very, very important. The first was in the 70s, when the Malaysian Rubber Producers Research Association produced in England the first steel elastomeric devices based on the vulcanization process. The first application were in USA and New Zealand, and also in Japan with a different kind type of rubber. The second event was the construction of the nuclear power plant at Croix with seismic isolation. Seismic isolation allowed using the same project used for other installations in site with a peak ground acceleration of 0.2 G, whereas the peak ground acceleration was 0.3 G at Croix. Well, the physical and the mathematical principle of seismic isolation can be easily understood with reference to this single degree of freedom system, this portal. If we insert isolators under the columns and obviously also an additional rigid beam between them, we obtain a 2 degree of freedom system. We can write the equilibrium equation, assuming as a Lagrangian coordinate the absolute horizontal displacement of the floor. So we can find the model shapes. And the first involves mainly or only the isolator. The second model shape involves also the portal, the superstructure. So we can write the equilibrium equation in the model space in terms of principal coordinates and consider the participating factor. In order to have the participating factor of the second model shape very low, the parameter epsilon should be very, very small enough. It is equal to the squared ratio between the fundamental period of the structure considered at the fixed base structure and the fundamental period of the isolated structure. So we can conclude that the fundamental period of the isolated structure must be much higher, at least 3 times, than the fundamental period of the fixed base structure. Well, seismic isolation is not the good medicine for the old disease, but there are some requirements to be addressed. The superstructure must be rigid enough to guarantee the coupling of motion, as said. For the same reason, seismic isolation is not recommended in the presence of soft, very soft soil. Seismic isolation requires also joints between the building and the adjacent structure. The energy dissipation systems are a good alternative solution. More detail about the history of seismic isolation can be found in this paper I can send you to you all after this webinar. Well, let's go to the second step, second chapter, isolation devices. And it is important, first of all, to remind that isolation devices have mainly a supporting function. They bear vertical loads in operating condition and under seismic condition, of course. So they must have a low horizontal stiffness to allow the relative displacement in case of seismic events, but also an adequate stiffness against low horizontal forces such as wind, traffic, induced vibration, and so on. Also a good capability of dissipation, recentering, and lateral constraint under service horizontal loads. The last functions can also be entrusted to auxiliary devices. These are the most common devices to be used. We have rubber bearings, natural or high damping rubber bearings. we have plane sliding devices, bottom left. We have a curved surface slider at the top right. And finally, linear recirculating guides. These are used mainly in Japan, not in Italy, probably due to their cost. So let's start with the elastomeric isolators. They have a cylindrical shape, as you know, with the external diameter DE. They are made of horizontal rubber layer of thickness TI and total thickness TE, steel laminates of diameter D, a little less than DE, and thickness TS, this is at least 2 millimeters. Then we have 2 steel plates at the top, at the bottom of the isolator, with a thickness of at least 20 millimeter. This portion is vulcanized, hot vulcanized. Then we have 2 steel plates, upper and lower, which each of them with 4 anchors in practice. We define the first shape factor S1, which is related to the local instability, and the second shape factor S2, which is related to the global instability. The devices are characterized by the horizontal stiffness and a vertical stiffness. Their ratio is very important to avoid vertical modes. Well, the behavior is characterized by force displacement curve. For each cycle, we have 2 parameters, the equivalent stiffness given by the ratio between the maximum force and the maximum displacement reached in the cycle, and the equivalent viscous damping, Xe, which is a function of the area contained in the in each cycle. Usually, these parameters are defined with reference to the design displacement, I mean to the maximum displacement during an earthquake. Each layer of rubber is subjected to shear, compression, and bending, which cause angular strain, deformation. Due to shear deformation, the effective area obviously is reduced, as you can see from the first picture on the left. The codes usually require the following check. The check of the shear strain, the maximum shear strain, the check of the total shear strain, the summation of the 3 components of the shear strain, shear, compression and bending, the stability check, and the check of the stress in steel laminates. Well, for a fixed value of the damping, we can define a maximum value, TV, of the effective isolation period for which the demand base shear VD is, in the superstructure, of course, is exactly equal to its base shear capacity, VC. And also a maximum value, TD, of the effective isolation period, which contains lateral seismic displacement, DE, into a preset limit. The effective isolation period, TIS, is included between these two limits. From T isolation, we can deduce the total horizontal stiffness, key total, and from this, according to the layout of the elastomeric isolators, the stiffness of the single isolators, key E. And the total rubber is VE, and considering both the expression of key E and VE, we can write the volume of rubber as you can see in the formula on the right of this slide. In the plane, on the plane VED, this relationship represents a curve. We'll call this curve key curve. Obviously, if the period TV is greater than TD, there is something wrong. We have to consider high value of damping, otherwise isolation is not possible. Well, the previous inequalities of the codes can be also expressed in terms of rubber volume. So we can deduce the formulas on the right from the same formulas on the left. And these inequalities on the plane VD represent a portion of the plane and bordered by a curve. These curves depends on the value of the design parameters, of course, but in the diagram on the right, you can see how these curves varies if you increase the thickness of the single rubber layer. Well, these inequalities define an area in practice. In the VD plane, we call it admissible area. And all the points of this area respect the condition of the codes, the design condition A to D. If we insert the key curve, the red line in this diagram, all the solutions that meet the design requirement and the code conditions are identified by the portion of this curve inside the admissible area. Obviously, the optimum solution is represented by the smallest isolator on this portion of the curve, which is the one corresponding to the intersection point between the key curve, the KE curve, and the admissible area boundary. Well, obviously, the admissible area and the intersection with the K curve depend on the value of the design parameter. But in practice, some parameter can be not considered in the sense that the stiffness KE is known, is a design parameter which is defined previously. The displacement and the axial vertical load N are design parameter already fixed. And the rotation alpha is very small in building and can be assumed with, substituted with a conventional value, for example, that given in the slides. So in practice, we have just three parameter, the shear modulus G, the thickness TI, and the total the thickness of the steel laminates TS. Well, I don't have time, of course, to go in detail, but we set up a suitable procedure for the optimum design and with using this flowchart. And detail about that, you can find detail about that in this paper, which is online, has been online for a few months, but is published, will be published in the next month, I think. Well, the equivalent viscous damping can be increased up to 20-30% by inserting one or more lead cores within rubber bearings. Advantages, disadvantages, well, isolator can be made in low damping rubber, natural rubber, which is more resistant to failure. The manufacturing process is more difficult and the centering capability is lower. Let's go to sliding devices, usually steel PTFE bearings with low friction thanks to lubrification. Their load carrying capacity is independent of the displacement, of course, but they have no recentering capacity. Therefore, they are used with rubber bearings or other auxiliary devices. And then we have the curved surface sliders. They, without the contribution of other element, have the recentering function. I mean the device return to its initial position and the dissipation function. Sliding surfaces are not lubricated like in the previous case, so friction is quite high. Friction pendulum were developed in the USA in the end of the last millennium century. and later seismic isolation pendulum were developed more recently in Germany with the polyethylenic material, and then also in Italy, also with different sliding material. We have single curved surface sliders on the left, but we have also double curved surface sliders. The difference is that the double CSS guarantee larger displacement, but friction could be different for the different surfaces. So sliding on one friction surface is first put in action, started, then also on the other, for example. This could happen. Nowadays, we have also double curved surface sliders in which the internal element is not articulated. I don't like this type, this kind of device. And you also have a triple curved surface slider, but the problem of the difference in between the different surfaces is much more evident. In order to understand the principle of a curved surface slider, consider a simple pendulum. We write the equilibrium equation between the inertia force and the weight component, and we deduce that the stiffness depends on the mass. So the period is independent of the mass, exactly like a simple pendulum. In practice, the behavior is much more complex because we have three kinds of friction. Mu zero, the static friction at the onset of motion, mu, the dynamic friction during the motion, and mu one, which is the friction factor at the change of velocity sign. Usually for application, we use a simplified bilinear model, and the damping is related to dynamic friction and to the radius of curvature, of course, and also the period T. And in any case, the static friction could be important. We'll see something in detail about the static friction later, because it should guarantee a good stiffness with reference to the static loads and load seismic events. Well, several models have been proposed. I suggest to you this model setup proposed by Gandelli, Lomiento, Benzoni, and other colleagues, and because it allows accounting for the static friction. The friction coefficient is, in this case, given by the product of two functions. One is a function of the axial, the vertical load and the velocity, and a function of the heat generated at the sliding surface because of the energy dissipation. Obviously, all these parameters, constants in the formula, in this formula, must be determined experimentally. So it's a quite complex model, and also it's not easy to evaluate this constant. You can see on the left the diagram of the friction coefficient, which reduces with the vertical load n for three value of the sliding velocity. Of course, zero means static friction. On you also can see that the friction force mu n increases with n, of course, but less than a linear law. On the right, you can see the friction coefficient for as a function of the velocity for three values of the axial vertical loads on the device. Well, a larger investigation, we can read out a large investigation on the onset of motion, considering different numbers of devices, different heights of the horizontal forces, we can see on the right, and different values of the reference friction. And we plotted the curves of the variability of the axial force, vertical loads on each device, and also the friction force versus the horizontal acceleration. And the conclusion of this large investigation, which is directly related to the experimental analysis I'll show you at the end of this presentation, can be summarized as follows. A limited number of devices is to be preferred in order to minimize the seismic force which induces the motion. And the variability of the vertical load on the devices due to the overturning moment due to the height of the application of the resultant of horizontal seismic action does not influence significantly the seismic force which induces the motion. And also the presence of asymmetry is not very important on the onset of a motion. But the friction coefficient depends strongly on the vertical load on the devices. And so the actual period in practice is not independent of the mass, because the mass, the low vertical load, influences the friction coefficients on the devices. And so other consideration I'll show you in later. About this this subject, we're publishing this paper. It should be appear in Nature Journal in the next month. It has been already accepted. How can we combine the different kind types of devices? Well, the elastomeric isolators can be considered alone without any other types of isolator. They can be associated with the sliding devices. Sliding devices cannot be considered alone, but only with elastomeric isolator or with auxiliary devices. Curved surface slider can be used alone or with other auxiliary devices. Let's see how we can perform a preliminary design of seismic isolation system. Well, in practice, we have to realize an isolation interface between the superstructure and the substructures, substructure which includes the foundation. We realize a full isolation if the design seismic condition, in the design seismic condition, the structure remains within the elastic range. Otherwise, the superstructure is only partially isolated. With a full isolation, we realize the zero earthquake damage building. Partial isolation is not a good solution. If a superstructure will damage, its period of vibration gets higher and could be close to the isolation period. Where the isolator should be placed? Well, it is not necessary for the isolator to be on the same horizontal layer, but each of them must be placed horizontally. Structural elements between isolators and the supporting deck must be rigid enough in comparison with the devices themselves. And the isolation interface is a continuous interface which passes through all the isolators without intersecting neither the superstructure nor the substructure. Inspection and replacement should be guaranteed for all the devices. The gap as well as the gaps necessary between the superstructure and the ground or the nearby structure. Well, what about the deployment of the isolator in elevation? Obviously at the lowest story, it's the best solution because so we protect the entire building. And for a fixed level, the best location is at top of the level, because if the isolators are at the bottom, you can see on the picture on the right, the column, the wall, will not shake together with the lower floor. As a result, a gap should be considered to absorb this relative displacement. So you cannot use completely the floor. What about the distribution in plan? Well, it is easy to state that for reinforced concrete building, we put an isolator under each column, while for masonry building, we put an isolator mainly at the wall crossings and maybe other, if necessary, other isolators between them. In case of a masonry building, a suitable structure to transfer the action from the wall to the foundation to the devices must be realized. Well, furthermore, other requirements are that we should optimize the dynamic behavior of the building, obtaining that the first two modes are translationals. Translational. This can be obtained easily if the projection of the center of mass is very close to the center of stiffness of the isolation system. If we use a rubber beading slider, this should be mainly along the perimeter to have a suitable torsion stiffness. At least 4 rubber bearings, I think at least 8 rubber bearings, because redundancy is very important when using seismic isolation. If we use curved surface sliders, the coincidence between the two centers, mass and stiffness, is automatic from a theoretical point of view, at least. Well, it is very important to fix the design earthquake, and the European code and Italian code are quite different formally, at least formally. In both cases, the reference earthquake is that with a probability of exceedance of 10% in 50 years, and in both cases, a higher safety level is required for the isolation devices. According to the Euro code, we account for the importance of a structure by amplifying the elastic spectrum by an importance factor, 1.2 for relevant building structures, 1.4 for strategic structure. Then for the check of the isolator, we amplify the design displacement obtained from the previous analysis by 1.2. According to the Italian code, we account for the importance of a structure by reducing the probability of exceedance of the design earthquake, so considering in practice higher seismic acceleration. For the check of isolator, lower values of probability of exceedance are considered. This in this slide, you can see typical values we used. Modeling of superstructure and substructure is very easy because they are linear elastic systems. The modeling of the isolation system could be quite hard, especially if you want to account for the nonlinear behavior, for example, of the cable surface sliders. It is also important to compare the static load combination, in which we have the self-weight G1, the other permanent load G2, these are symbol of the Italian code, and the variable loads QK. All of them are amplified by load factor gamma. In the seismic component, which are 1.3, 1.5, in the seismic combination, the red one in this slide, the loads are not amplified, and so the only safety factor is related to the reduction of the strength of the material. It is also important to consider always, almost always, the vertical component, because a vertical acceleration can reduce the vertical load, for example, on a masonry wall, but also on a concrete column, and so reduce its shear resistance. How we fix the isolation period? Well, on the basis of architectural consideration, economic evaluation, we choose the spectral amplitude SE star and find, so we fix the horizontal dotted line in this diagram and the blue line, and find the isolation period very easily as the intersection point with the acceleration spectrum. Obviously, this is a good value for the isolation period if this value guarantees a suitable decoupling of motion, but also a suitable value of the displacement. When this isolation period has been fixed, a preliminary design can be done using a simple model of a rigid body on elastic horizontal springs. 3 degree of freedom system, 2 translation and 1 rotation. Suppose that the first 2 modes are translation in the 2 main direction. And practice from the value of the period, we deduce the stiffness, total stiffness of the isolation system. If we use rubber bearings as slider, we deduce the radius if we consider curved surface sliders. I don't want to go in detail about calculation. In any case, you have the displacement of the spectrum. Then you have the conventional accidental eccentricity to consider. You have to consider the summation of this displacement in each direction. And then you have to combine the displacement due to the seismic action along to orthogonal direction. But these rules can be very different from one country to another. Well, these are typical seismic joints. It's not difficult to realize seismic joints in different situations, as well as it's not difficult to realize flexible pipes to connect the pipes in the building and those in the soil. In this paper, you can find design and optimization criteria for the elastomeric isolator system. And in this other paper, you can find instead issues related to design of curved surface slider systems. And finally, in this paper, you can find some consideration about the application of seismic isolation in masonry buildings. So let's go to chapter number 4, application of seismic isolation in Italy, new and existing building. Well, actually, the first modern application of seismic isolation in Italy dates 1976 and concerns the Somplago viaduct, which survived the Friuli earthquake in 1976. The viaduct was under construction at the time of the Friuli earthquake. Then the first application in buildings dates 1981 and concerned a fire command building in Naples. It is a steel structure suspended from a top reticular beam, which is supported by reinforced concrete tower. Then in 1991 was completed the Telecom Italia Center of the Marche region at Ancona with almost 300 high damping rubber bearings, and also impressive on-site release tests were performed on one of the 5 buildings. A significant increase of the application occurred in Italy after the Molise earthquake 2002 and especially after the L'Aquila earthquake 2009. among the most interesting application, I think it is worth reminding the new school at San Giuliano di Puglia, which was the first school in Italy to be designed with base isolation. It is composed of two buildings rising from a single base deck. This is a very, very beautiful buildings, the Civil Protection Center at Foligno, an hemispherical building supported only by only 10 elastomeric isolators along the perimeter. The elevator and the stairs, the structure of the elevator and the stairs is suspended and from the structure. Without any support at its base. I'll go back to this building at the last of my presentation about the when I speak about the experimental analysis. The use of seismic isolation increased rapidly after L'Aquila earthquake of 2009, when buildings for temporary hosting the homeless residents were realized. And this consisted in prefabricated houses made of reinforced concrete, steel, or wood, each of them placed on an isolated platform, reinforced concrete slab of about 20 for 60 meters, and supported by 40 isolators. All of them were curved surface slider. They were installed at the top of 40 columns, rising from a foundation plate. This is the tallest building in Italy. It is in Messina, just 8th floor. Don't laugh, please. And while this is a tall building in Rome, where seismic isolation has been used to realize a TMD at the top of the building, the mass, the last three floors has been used as mass for the tuned mass damper at the top of this building. And one of the most interesting field of application is that of the hospitals. These are two very recent cases under construction in central Italy with seismic isolation and also viscous dampers. Well, most of the applications in Italy are for the retrofit of existing buildings. In this case, of this building, Latini Buildings in Fabriano, a new sub-foundation was realized. The existing foundation, you can see on the left top, consisted of plinths on two piles each. The existing plinths were reinforced, and new large columns with new plinths and new piles were built under the existing plinths. The isolation devices were inserted between the old and the new structure by using a flat jack injected with epoxy resin. They were put in action with these flat jacks. Then the two piles, two old piles, you can see on the left bottom were cut. You can see on the right bottom, so the structure was definitely separated from the new foundation. Usually, we use another kind of techniques. We insert the isolator by cutting the column, and this was used in this building in L'Aquila. Each column was first enlarged in the lower portion, then metal brackets were used and hydraulic jacks were placed between them to unload the portion of the column to be removed. The portion of the column was cut by means of a diamond wire, and finally the isolator was inserted. This is a quite interesting techniques proposed by the Soles company in Italy. Point one, the existing building. Point two, a first foundation plate not connected, not linked to the building and supported by piles was realized. Point three, a second foundation, this time linked to the structure, was realized just above the previous one. And point four, hydraulic jacks were put between the two foundations, and the building was lifted by means of these jacks. And then the isolators were inserted between the two foundations, and so the work was completed. Well, seismic isolation has also been used for cultural heritage structures. In this case, two new sub-foundations were realized. The upper one consisted in a continuous concrete, in continuous concrete beams. The lower one was composed by plinths, which were then connected to each other by means of a reinforced concrete plane. Isolation devices were placed between them. These are the construction phases. Obviously, the work were done. The works were done acting on small portion, one at a time, of course. And you can see the foundation after the work. You can see the continuous beam and below the plinths, and between them the isolation devices. Well, this system in these slides allows the application of the isolation system under the foundation in the ground without touching the superstructure. Therefore, it is a suitable solution, especially for cultural heritage buildings. This system can be applied also to entire aggregates of historical centers, very common to Italy and not only, in most countries of the Europe. Let's see the construction phases. First, the excavation of a trench at one side of the building, then the insertion of horizontal adjacent pipes by means of pipe jacking or microtunneling, the so-called no-dig techniques, diameter of the pipes at least 2 meters to allow inspection. The piece of pipes have a particular shape. They are composed by two portions, the lower and upper cylindrical sectors, connected by means of removable elements. The red one will be removed and substituted with the isolator. The gray one will be just removed. The next phases are the removal of the connection red element and joining each paper with the two adjacent ones, positioning of the isolation devices, removal of the other connection elements, the gray, so-called the gray element. Well, finally, we realize walls around the building, and if necessary, a rigid connection between the building and the hearth, below it, and or between the building and the walls. A similar system, this time for new buildings, has been proposed recently by ENEA and TECVA. It is an artificial ground above which you can build as it was, because you realize, I already said, an artificial ground, so the seismic action above it are reduced a lot. Obviously, also, this is a very good solution to the built historical center as they was, sorry. Well, this is a recent state of the art written by my friend Alessandro Martelli and myself, and published last year. You can find lots of application in Italy in this paper, and in this other paper you can find a retrofit by means of seismic isolation of a strategic building in Italy. The analysis of vulnerability analysis and then retrofit. And finally, in this paper, the pipe system is described well, and also the application and the issues about the earth, the soil, and the building. So let's go to the last chapter of my presentation and experimental seismic response of base solidity building in Italy. Isolated buildings behaved very well also under very strong earthquake. We have examples in Japan, USA, New Zealand, and also in China. In Italy, we haven't had recently strong effects on isolated building, but we have also only low energy earthquake on isolated building. I think this is important to analyze what happened when the earthquake energy is not as high as that related to the design event. So let's start from this building. I've already shown you this building, the operative center at Foligno. It has been instrumented by using 12 accelerometer, three are at the basement on the foundation, of course. A1 to A3, A4 to A10 are just above the isolation system at the first floor, and two are at the top of the building, A11, A12. We recorded all the events of the seismic sequence in central Italy, started on August 24th, 2016. And you can see yellow point indicates the event, the epicenter of the event with the magnitude higher than 4. And in red, you have the epicenters of the event with magnitude higher than 5 and up to 6.5. In the diagram on the right, you see the magnitude versus the epicenter distance of the building. In the picture on the left, you can see at the top left, CPC is the position of our building with respect to all the epicenters. And the circle of the diagram on the right has an amplitude proportional to the energy at the foundation, evaluated by using the areas intensity defined in the formula in this slide. These are the recordings obtained during the strongest earthquake of October 30, 2016, Norcia earthquake. As you can see, there is no amplification from the basement to the top, but you can also see a change in the frequency content. This change is apparent also in the spectra. In this spectra, you can see peaks in both directions at about 1 Hz, and also some amplification between 8 and 9 Hz related to the superstructure, of course. It is important to remind that the design frequency was only 0.38 Hz. So we didn't find during this very low energy earthquake the design frequency. The rotated spectrum allows individualizing the horizontal direction of the movement associated to the resonance frequencies. And as you can see, the direction demonstrated a non-perfect polar symmetry of the structure, of course. But the frequency changed also during each event, in this case, during Norcia events, due to nonlinear behavior of the isolator. The fundamental frequency varies also from one event to the other. On the left, you can see the first frequency as a function of the areas intensity evaluated at the base of the building, on the right, as a function of the shear strain. What is the lesson that we can deduce from this experience? In my opinion, is that one should take into account that the dissonant frequency could increase too much and become very close to the resonance frequency of the superstructure under low earthquake. The detail of this analysis can be found in this paper published last year on this international journal. This is another example. In this case, buildings were isolated by means of a curved surface slider, and consider the same earthquake, Norcia earthquake of magnitude 6.5. We are very far from the epicenter, about more than 60 kilometers. In any case, you can see that the amplification from the foundation to the top is very apparent. There is no decoupling of motion in practice. And this is confirmed by the analysis of the in the frequency domain. You can see that in the spectra, the resonance, the most important resonance were from 3 hertz and more. In you can see the relative displacement between the first floor just above the isolation system and the foundation, where the relative displacement were very, very low, especially in one direction, and quite a bit higher where the displacement between the top and the first floor. What is the reason? I think this was related to the choice of the friction coefficient. It was equal to 3%, but was defined as a function of the ultimate vertical load. So it was much higher than under vertical load in seismic condition. In practice, you have the red arrow during the design phase and the green arrow in practice during the earthquake. I think that what can we understand? What is the lesson in this case? Well, the onset of motion should be analyzed carefully, and the seismic action on the superstructure could be much higher than those assumed in the design. More detailed analysis, more data can be found in this paper published last year, but we're publishing other paper on this subject. And this is my last slide. I hope the translation in Turkish is good. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Paolo Clemente, for a very interesting and excellent presentation. We will go ahead and take some time for questions now. Just a reminder, please be sure to type your questions into the question box in your control panel in TASI YouTube channel. Let me check the questions. First one, Bahadur Shahdan. How are the seismic isolation retrofit projects of residential buildings financed? Do the residents pay all the costs, or is there a financial support by the Italian government?
Well, in the example I just showed you, we were in sites where in area where recent earthquake occurred. So the reconstruction was financed by the government. But now in Italy, we have another kind of financing model, because you can retrofit your building, improve your building, and you can obtain a reduction on your taxes in the next years, up to 100% of what you have spent.
Thank you. Also, Erkan Güven, Which type of earthquake isolator should we use? LRB, HTRB, or friction pendulum bearing?
I prefer the Elastomeric isolators, but both they are both can be used in Italy and I think in other countries. I prefer elastomeric isolator because friction is it's not an easy issue, but we can use both in Italy, not only elastomeric isolators. Curved surface sliders are maybe used more than elastomeric isolators recently because of their costs. The cost is lower than the cost of elastomeric isolators in Italy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you think it depends on the country or earthquake risk? Do you mean, or?
Well, in Italy, the curved surface slider were used first after L'Aquila earthquake. Mm-hmm. So the application is not very recent, but quite recent in any case. In other countries, such as USA, they use much more, and they use also double and triple isolators. I think it's a problem also of the cost, because friction pendulum costs much. The cost of friction pendulum is lower than the cost of rubber bearings.
Thank you. Eren Uçkan asks, how is the application of base isolation for the tall building? Is it applied together with a TMD, a twin mass damper?
Well, this is a question that is not good for an Italian researcher, because we don't have tall buildings in Italy. Okay. No, I'm joking. In any case, the application of seismic isolation to tall buildings is quite hard, obviously. And in Japan, they use the linear recirculating guides, which can guarantee a reaction to traction, not only to compression, of course. And I think this is a good solution. In any case, when you want to isolate a tall building, you must reach very high periods, because at least 4 seconds, 6 seconds. And in this range of periods, also the behavior of the soil is not very clear and is not well known.
Okay. Also, I would like to ask one question about one of your slides talking about flat check. If you use flat check for the retrofit to retrofit one existing building, I think you don't need jacks to lift the structure. Is it right?
You don't have to lift the structure. Mm. You have to unload the column. So you have to consider jack to when you cut with a diamond wire the column. So you have to consider jacks in this case. And you can use also flat jacks with the Rex epoxy resin to put in action the isolator. Okay.
Then you don't need any other jack if you use flat jack.
No.
Mm-hmm. Okay. No. And also another question. Wahid Ali Nejadan, is the base isolation always a good option for reinforcement, or are there other size systems like BRB and?
A good system for?
BRB, I think.
BRB. No. The first part of the question.
Is the base isolation always a good option for reinforcement? It means retrofit. Or are there other systems like buckling, restraint, brace?
Yes. Okay, we have lots of possibilities, techniques to retrofit existing structures. When you can use seismic isolation, I think seismic isolation is the best one. but also other techniques can be used, such as energy dissipation devices, but also more conventional techniques. On Monday, we realized in Italy, last Monday, 2 days ago, pushover test, not analysis, not numerical, pushover test, a real pushover test.
Real pushover.
Quite very small course. And we had two very similar, equal buildings. One was not reinforced. The other one was reinforced by a new techniques with the mortar and on both floor, the buildings as the two floor. And we found that the strength of the building was at least three times of the previous one. I think we can use also other techniques. It depends on the case, and there is not the best medicine during my presentation. It depends on case by case. Any seismic isolation is a good solution when possible.
Okay, thank you. Also, Bahadur Shahdan, another question he has. For low seismic events, it seems that isolators with low lateral stiffness are needed. What is your suggestion for frequent earthquakes with low energy?
Well, this is a good question. I think that this is one of the reasons for which I prefer elastomeric isolators, because rubber bearings have a very high stiffness for small strain, okay, but they move 1 millimeter, 2 millimeters, 1 centimeter, okay, like in the case of the Civil Protection Center in Foligno. Instead, curved surface slider could have zero displacement. In this case, you have a rigid building, and the entire acceleration goes to the superstructure, which is not protected in practice at all. In any case, I think that the friction in the second case and the stiffness of the rubber should be evaluated very well. It is not enough to check the structure only under the strongest earthquake. We should analyze what happened at a different level of earthquake.
Okay. Also, Ümit Özkan asks, how is the maintenance of installed isolators followed in Italy?
Well, the application in Italy is quite recent, so we didn't have up to now problem of maintenance. In any case, we asked when a building is realized to carry out a check every year of the isolator, a check, a visual check, of course, a check after any strong or important seismic event. Once, in one case, we substituted the devices because they turned to be not good during the construction of the building. And this was a case in which I worked together with my friend Alessandro Martelli. I already mentioned it.
And Alessandro Martelli says to us hello. And also he mentioned the isolators Alessandro Martelli personally like most are the HDRBs, just if you have problems to allow for a sufficiently large structural gap, he says, I will use LRBs. However, pay attention not to have a too large damping because it may be detrimental for protection of some inner elements or components. Due to possible amplification at somewhat high frequencies at around 10 Hz, he says like that.
This is not a question, this is a lesson.
No, 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 just a comment. And also he says, good evening, hello. And also Bahadır Şah'dan another question. Could you please give some brief information about the testing facilities in Italy?
Well, about the testing isolation devices, we have three, four laboratories. And for example, in University of Milan, University of Padua, and a smaller one at University of Basilicata. And we also have a large facility in Messina to test large devices, quite similar to the facility in San Diego. And actually we are, I think that the problem in testing large devices are well known, and the problem are related to the possibility of keeping or varying the axial, the vertical load during the test. And this is very important, especially for the curved surface slider, but not only, also for the rubber bearings. And not all the our laboratories are able to do that. In any case, we are improving our laboratory. Then we have in at Enea Casaccia, we have a shake table for different shake table of different sites, and where we can also test devices and structures.
Also, can I ask one question? Do you have any bad experience for the base isolated buildings in Italy during the real event?
During?
The real earthquake.
Well, only the case I showed you with the very low earthquake. In practice, the isolated building did not suffer a strong earthquake up to now. In any case, we have monitored a few buildings, at least three, four by ENA and eight by the Civil Protection Department in L'Aquila. So we have from 10 to 20, more or less, isolated building, which are monitored, so we can analyze data in case of earthquake, of course. But up to now, we did have strong earthquake on isolated buildings in Italy.
And also, I think last question from Ian Aiken from USA. Hi, Paolo. Very nice overview. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can you make some comment about the design philosophy in Italy for beyond design level earthquake? Is there any consideration to ensure additional capacity? I think reserve capacity.
Well, as I said, I showed you a slide about the design earthquake in Italy, and we use the philosophy of increasing the return period or reducing the probability of accidents to consider for isolated building. So actually, the superstructure is usually designed to support a certain level of earthquake, and the isolation system to support a higher level of earthquake. We the considering higher level of earthquake is not requested by the Italian code. This is for usual building, but when considering strategic building in practice, we consider earthquake with a very, very large return period. And for particular plant, we don't have nuclear power plant in Italy, but we have high risk plant. For example, in this case, we consider particular specific studies in to realize the structure in general, and also obviously also isolated structures, if any. In any case, the analysis of what happened if a higher atrial chord is not considered in the normal design in Italy. I'm sorry, Ian, it's like that.
Okay, and also one question from Professor Mustafa Erdik. A nice presentation. In friction pendulum bearings, sometimes the startup friction coefficient could be higher than the nominal one. Do you have any experience for this kind of
first of all, I
behavior in Italy?
First of all, I would like to thank Mustafa for listening to me this evening. Well, in Italy, directly, we don't have experience like that. But I remember listening to some colleagues, other laboratories, the static friction could be very much higher than those we can suppose. Also, 3-4 times, especially when a friction pendulum is not working for a long period. So if you have, for example, a static friction of 8%, you can find also 20-25% if you stay, if you leave this pendulum not operating for a few days.
Okay, thank you. And also Wahid Ali Nejadan, in the tests performed, did the Malaysian rubbers had a best performance? Like that he asked Wahid Ali Nejadan.
Sorry?
In the test performed, did the Malaysian rubbers had a best performance? I don't know. How can you answer this?
Maybe.
Okay, then also Alessandro Martelli again some comments. The only Italian isolated building that was struck by significant earthquake was in Fabriano in 2016. During the Norcia earthquake of October 30. It was the first European building retrofitted thanks to seismic isolation in a sub-foundation.
Yes, I showed you the intervention on that building of Fabriano. Thank you, Alessandro. Yes, and this Fabriano was not very far from the epicenters of the central Italy earthquake, not in epicentral area, but not far, not very far from. And in any case, Alessandro showed that this building had no damage after this seismic sequence. Instead, building in the same area suffered, not isolated building, in the same area suffered quite important damage. That's true.
Thank you. And also Mr. Albayrak asks, which do you prefer in terms of being effective against vertical shocks?
Well, it is very important. I said that it is very important to consider the vertical action in general, because vertical action are contemporary to horizontal action, of course. And the vertical action can reduce the compression in masonry on, or also in a concrete column. About the seismic isolation, we usually do not isolate with reference to vertical action. Devices are rigid in vertical direction. Vertical isolation is considered only for a particular plant, for example, nuclear power plant or pipelines or such kind of structures. But usually the structure is rigid in vertical direction.
Thank you. Also, Ümit Özkan, can you compare the uplift performance of rubber and friction pendulum systems in terms of vertical accelerations and damping? I think same.
Yes.
Question. Also, Adriana Guisasol Solo.
Guisasol.
You know, he says, thank you, Paolo. Hello, Alessandro. He says, no, I think no questions. I think it looks like we have covered all of our questions. Mr. Paolo Clemente, is there anything else you wanted to cover before we finish?
Me? No.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Thank you, everyone. We appreciate you being here. We will continue webinar series. Therefore, please follow our social media accounts for our next webinars. Thanks again for joining us today, and we will see you
Thank
next you time.
Thank you to you all.
Thank you, Dr. Paolo Clemente. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Nice evening. Bye.